Thank you, Mohammed. Can you all see my slide and listen to me?
Yeah, we see it. Yes, we see it.
Okay, very good. So I have changed the title of my presentation. Sorry, I will talk about how to recycle carbon dioxide through catalytic hydrogenation, well, which at the end is not far from the original one. But let me go straight into it because we don't have a lot of time and I don't like to take more than what I was given. So I start by acknowledging all the researchers that have contributed to this work. And this is mostly work done here at the Catalysis Center in collaboration with Professor Manny Sarati from the Clean Combustion Center and in collaboration with the Universidad de Navarra in Spain with Alberto Navajas. So let's go to carbon dioxide recycling. It's obvious that one of the options that we have with carbon dioxide is to store it, and that has advantages, especially in terms of volume that can be stored. However, it will be good if part of the CO2 that we need to recycle from the atmosphere is actually brought back to the production chain. So if this is what we are considering, I think that we all have to have something very clear. And is that here we are talking about very different scales. We are emitting a lot of gigatons of carbon dioxide. And if we want some of those gigatons to be reused, we have to look at the markets in which that CO2 can be recycled. Also, there is quite a lot, let me just select my laser pointer. There is quite a lot of work devoted to the transformation of carbon dioxide into polymers. This is a fantastic business, probably from a business point of view. However, the impact that polymers derived from CO2 are going to have in the whole issue of CO2 utilization is not going to be big. And it's not going to be big because that market is a small one. It's a niche market, right? Now, if we move a little bit more towards the right in this graph made by the International Energy Agency, you will very easily realize that using CO2 to cure concrete, which is a system that is relatively well known to make these aggregates, can have a very high impact in terms of climate benefits and also a relatively good impact in terms of carbon dioxide that can be sequestered per year. We will get to the 5 gigatons of carbon dioxide per year. Now, we have other options, and the two options that I am mostly going to talk about today, which is in this space that belongs obviously to the catalysis territory, which is either making chemical intermediates or making fuels out of carbon dioxide. Here in the chemical intermediates, carbon dioxide will always compete with oil. And actually, I'm more of the opinion of using oil to make chemical intermediates and to actually stop burning oil in the form of fuels. Much more if we can actually make carbon dioxide recyclable and make fuels that are CO2 neutral, which is what most of my presentation will deal with. Also, this is what I want to talk about. Let me go a little bit further. If you are interested in real numbers of how much megatons of carbon dioxide can be taken by making different products out of carbon dioxide, please go to this review article that we published last year. Now we have set up the scene, we can do this transformation through many different ways, right? So to go from carbon dioxide to valuable products, one can try to mimic completely photosynthesis and rely on photocatalysis, which is what you have here on this part. One can use natural solutions like algae and then further process those algae to final products. One can go for pure electrocatalytic approach in which you take water, you take carbon dioxide, green energy and do the transformation, or you can go to a hybrid system in which hydrogen plays a huge role. So you generate green hydrogen from water, and then you use traditional thermocatalysis to do the transformation of carbon dioxide to the final products. Right. I'm a scientist. We like to say that we learn from nature on how nature operates. So basically what we want to do here is an artificial photosynthesis. So let's look at how nature does photosynthesis in reality. But you can see if you go a little bit into detail into how photosynthesis works is that it relies on processes that happens under light illumination and reactions that happen in the dark. And actually the real magic in photosynthesis does not happen under illumination. What happens under illumination is the simple process that you can imagine. It's just a 2-electron reduction in which out of NADP+, you generate a very strong reducing agent. NADPH that is used in the dark to do the whole transformation in the Calvin cycle from carbon dioxide to sugars. So taking this learning in hand, I like to always to say, and I like to use Lord Vader for this, to say that the key to selectivity and productivity in the transformation of CO2 is actually in the dark side. And this brings us to propose that probably the best method and the most economically efficient method to transform carbon dioxide into valuable products is to take renewable energies, make hydrogen out of these renewable energies, and then go for traditional catalysis in the dark, where we feed carbon dioxide and hydrogen to make our final products, whatever they might be, right? So which families of reactions can we do with hydrogen and carbon dioxide? Well, I think that one of the most interesting ones is making methanol out of carbon dioxide because of two very simple reasons. This is a reaction that can be very selective so that we will not be dealing with a lot of waste. And second, because methanol, the main product of this reaction, is an absolutely fantastic chemical intermediate. An absolutely fantastic chemical intermediate that I'm sure many of you are aware has been proposed about as to be the molecule of the future in the so-called methanol economy. This is what gave George Ola the Nobel Prize, and there is a very good reason behind it. Once you have methanol, you can make almost every chemical that is produced at this moment in any petrochemical plant, starting from oil. But more interestingly, you can also transform methanol directly into fuels that will be directly compatible with the combustion engines that we are having at this moment. Right? So in this sense, methanol is a super versatile molecule. Now, if you want to make a better CO2 hydrogenation to methanol process, you obviously have to focus on the catalyst, but you have to be aware of the full process. This is a very simplified scheme of the process, and there are certain aspects in which one can focus to make this process more economically viable, which is at the end what we want to do, right? So one of them is that we operate this system at relatively high pressures. Making catalysts that will be equally productive at lower pressures will be very convenient. The second aspect is that this is a very exothermic reaction. And a big problem of many of these catalysts is that when you increase the temperature inside of the reactor, they become far less selective. So having selectivity at high temperatures will be very convenient because we could have much higher productivities at equal selectivities. And at the same time, we will need to recycle far less of the unreacted reactants because this is a highly equilibrium limited reaction. And finally, we have to avoid by all means having secondary products like methane during this hydrogenation, because this basically makes a bleed where we are going to lose a lot of our most expensive reactant, which is going to be the green hydrogen, and we will end up emitting gases with quite a high greenhouse effect. So to make a very long story short, what we have done at KCC over the last few years is we came up with a completely new catalyst formulation, which we summarize the performance of this catalyst in this graph. Basically, we are plotting here methanol selectivity and methanol conversion at different conditions in terms of temperature and space yield. What you can see is that we can reach productivities of methanol, which is the blue line, very close to 1 gram of methanol per gram of catalyst per hour, which is certainly among the highest. On this line, which represents selectivity, you will see that we are able to see this with selectivities very close to a 90% to methanol in one single pass, that we are able to do it at relatively high temperatures compared to the way other catalysts normally work for this reaction. So once we have a winner, we can compare it with the commercial catalyst, and what we can see is that indeed in the high temperature regime in which the productivity of the catalyst is much bigger than at lower temperatures, we are able to keep very high selectivities for methanol. Now, without going more into detail, something that I believe will be important for this presentation is, okay, you can do it, but how expensive can you make it? Is it already something that can compete with current methods of making methanol through syngas? Well, in order to do that, you need to do a full process optimization and a full process economic analysis, which is something that we have done. And here I am presenting three different cases in which obviously we assume that there is no taxation on carbon dioxide, so that actually we are paying a nice amount of money per ton of carbon dioxide used in the process, and we play with both the price of carbon dioxide and the price of green hydrogen. What you can see is that in scenarios like case two and case three, for instance, will be the most convenient one, in which we will pay in the order of $50 per ton of carbon dioxide. If we were able to have green hydrogen at a price of $1 per kilogram of hydrogen, we will already be economically viable, and we will break the even at prices of methanol in the order of $500 per ton of methanol, which is not far from the market fluctuations of the price of methanol. Obviously, we are not there yet, and these cases do not consider any CO2 taxation. Now you can imagine that in scenarios where CO2 taxations become important, these systems might become quite economically viable, probably in the next 10 or 15 years, which is, I believe, good news. Now there is another topic that is hardly touched when we propose new technologies, and is that, okay, we claim that this is good for the environment, but if you want to demonstrate that something is good for the environment, the best way of showing that is by doing a life cycle assessment of your whole process. So what I am going to present here is a life cycle assessment based on a plant of methanol using our catalyst that only makes use of renewable energy. In this case, it's a split between wind, photovoltaic, and a little bit of hydropower. This will correspond to the energy mix that is expected to have in countries like Spain by 2030. Every single piece of energy in this whole analysis is produced from renewable energy. We take the case for a natural gas plant that is producing power, where we capture carbon dioxide by amines, and then this carbon dioxide is transformed to methanol by using green hydrogen produced from green electricity. What you can see here is that indeed, well, these are the typical indicators for a life cycle analysis, where probably the most important is the GWP, which is the global warming potential. You can see that we decrease the global warming potential a lot. You can see that we decrease many other, well, quite some other indicators, which are quite important, like for instance, photochemical ozone formation or resource and energy carriers by quite a bit. However, I mean, this is good from a climate point of view. There are other issues that we need to take into consideration if we go full renewable in these cases. One of them is, for instance, land use. We may run into issues with land if we need to have very huge renewable energy units. Another one which really worries me is water usage, which at the end, if we are going to make hydrogen exclusively out of water and exclusively out of fresh water, this may create quite a lot of pressure in water usage in the future. And this is something that certainly whatever the direction we decide to go, we should keep a very close eye on, right? Once we have the LCA, we can see which factors affect more one and the other. And obviously you can see things like, obviously, in terms of water utilization, production of hydrogen is the main contributor. Obviously, in terms of global warming potential, all the CO2 that we are recycling is the main contributor to this negative effect, et cetera, et cetera. But again, from here, the main message will be not only the result of this LCA, but that really, if we want to go forward with new technologies that we claim are going to be good for our climate, we really need to do this type of analysis, and they are going to become more and more important. Now, my last couple of slides. What I mentioned before is that something which is extremely interesting about methanol is that you could, in principle, relatively easily make fuels compatible with existing powertrains if you use methanol as precursor. What we are trying to do now is develop processes that do not rely on making methanol and processing it somewhere else. We are trying to make just one pot processes in which we can have combinations of catalysts, a catalyst that makes methanol, and in situ that methanol is transformed directly into isoparaffins that will give you gasoline mixtures similar to the gasolines that you can get out of oil refining. The good news is that this indeed can be done. We can get very nice transformation directly of carbon dioxide to isoparaffins that contain mostly isopentanes, isobutanes, and isoheptanes, very little oxygenase in the process, and that we can do that in a very continued way and at a very at very good throughputs compatible with any industrial process. We are not there yet. We would like to have longer isoparaffins to be able to have real gasoline out of it rather than things that need to be mixed with something else. However, I think that we are in a very good track to come up with processes that can take green hydrogen, carbon dioxide, and directly make a fuel that is compatible with the cars that we have at home, which I think is going to be quite interesting. This was the last slide of my presentation, but since I heard that Akhil talk about the efforts of Aramco in oil to chemicals, I just wanted to give you a teaser of something that is coming out in a couple of days. This is a paper, a huge collaboration between Karst and Aramco, showing that we are indeed working in that direction, in the direction of making the most out of oil, working to make materials out of oil, and then leave that fuel space probably for some other things that are environmentally more friendly. So if you are interested, on February 25th at 4 o'clock, this paper will go online. And with that, let me thank you all for your attention. You are muted, Mohammed.